We will call the Standing Committee on Public Safety and National Security to order. This meeting be meeting number 36. We're continuing our study on Bill C-2 today. We have 2 hours of witness testimony today. For the first hour, we have with us Dean Wilson, prior plaintiff, and we have by video conference from Vancouver, from the Drug Prevention Network of Canada, David Berner, Executive Director, and we have from the Vancouver City Police Department, Inspector Scott Thompson, District 1 Commander, Operations Division. We welcome you all here today, gentlemen, on behalf of the committee. I would just provide notice to my colleagues, the second hour of debate, of testimony and questioning today will be cut short a little bit due to the bells. So I just give you notice now so that you can plan and be prepared for that. But we will now proceed with the first hour of business today. And so we will call the gentleman to the table here, and we will inform you that you have up to 10 minutes for an opening statement. So we are rather tight. The chair will keep you to that, and if you can make it a little bit shorter, too, that would be much appreciated. Okay. So first of all, we will call Mr. Dean Wilson. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you. I'm a little bit nervous here. Last time I was dressed like this in front of people like you, the last thing I heard was guilty as charged. Excuse me. I appreciate the chance to give testimony regarding Bill C-2, but I'm also confused. I thought the Supreme Court of Canada's decision of September 30th, 2011, finalized the issue of supervised injection sites. The court decided that supervised injection sites were legal and constitutional. I guess the present government feels that they can sidestep the highest court's decision, and because the legal route has now closed, that they will regulate supervised injection sites out of business. One only has to read the three judgments, the Supreme Court of British Columbia, the Appellate Court of British Columbia, and the Supreme Court of Canada, to feel the spirit in which the courts framed the supervised injection site issue within the laws of Canada. What those judgments specify is that supervised injection sites are a medical issue and should be treated as such. I know that the decisions do not sit well with the Conservative government and that they wish to shut down supervised injection sites, stating that they support the treatment of drug addicts over any harm reduction initiative. This is incredibly misleading, as the government does not support treatment either. The Auditor General's report of 2002 showed that 95 cents of every dollar the government spends on the illicit drug issue goes to enforcement, leaving only 5 cents for everything else, including treatment. This does not sound like support to me. In fact, it makes me feel that the federal government doesn't care about the most downtrodden of its citizens. I realize that drug addicts seem to be the new pariahs and that the only outcome is jail or the cemetery, but I believe from personal experience that everyone counts. I'm a 58-year-old man who presently has 5 years of sobriety. Before that, I was a street-entrenched poly-drug addict using heroin and cocaine, which very few people supported, even though I was a noted advocate for the rationalization around the drug issue, which was documented in the Genie Award-winning documentary, Fixed Story of Addicted City. Excuse me. I know the following seems counterintuitive, but it was the building of relationships with the medical staff at Insight that allowed myself to take the first step, that being detox. I relapsed the first few times, but through perseverance by the staff at Insight and myself, I now live a straight life. It proves that anyone can change. This change is what everyone in the downtown East Side really wants. This is not a party drug consumption place where people smoke a couple of joints on a Friday night. These streets are filled with people who have experienced incredible trauma in their lives and are just trying to cope. I recall the story of a 19-year-old girl that I met at Insight. She said that it was her birthday. I said, happy birthday, but she indicated that birthdays were incredibly sad to her. I asked why. She bluntly stated that on her 10th birthday, her father passed her around sexually to her three uncles. I was left speechless. How does anyone cope or recover from something so horrible? But this is just one of many stories in the downtown East Side of Vancouver, and I do not care what anyone says. That girl deserves whatever treatment is needed, including supervised injection. Sometimes I wonder if those opposed to our center actually know the full extent of the work that we do there. I think we do a disservice in Canada and Europe by the names that we call our sites. Drug consumption rooms in Europe and supervised injection sites in Canada are very descriptive, but only to a very small part of the services that we offer. In Canada, at Insight, our model is similar to the Drogenhaus treatment centers in Germany. These are multiple floor treatment centers where the higher up you go, the more involved your treatment. On the first floor at Insight, we have the supervised injection room, but also a chill room where we can observe people both before and after injection, a health room where nurses on site can triage, and also two staff members who circulate amongst the users and try to hook them up with whatever services might be needed. I have seen these staff members get housing for people to get them to healthcare, and in one case go so far as to get that person a bus ticket home, which we know had a very good outcome. On the second floor is the detoxification center. It is ironic that for a government that only believes in treatment, it took Insight, the supervised injection site, to open the first new detox in Vancouver that I'm aware of in decades. But it is the third floor that is critical. It is the transitional housing unit. Let me explain. Most people can detox from a drug they are using in 7 to 10 days, but most long-term treatment centers require 30 days clean before they will admit someone. This left us with a 20-day gap where the person leaving detox typically had to go back to the same environment that caused them to seek detox in the first place. The transitional housing unit therefore allows the person to stay in a treatment environment until they can get into long-term treatment centers. Bridging this 3-week gap has been the most important service that I have seen, second only to the critical initial intervention, that is the supervised injection. The results of all this have been documented in many scientific journals. As for the science behind supervised injection site, I can quote ad nauseum the scientific and medically published papers in support of Insight. In fact, there are over 60 published papers in support of Insight, and I have yet to see one that does not support the work being done there. In the Bill C-2, Canadian Police Association President Tom Stamatakis is quoted as saying that in his experience, supervised injection sites lead to an increase in criminal behavior. This is not backed up by science. Papers in both Canada and Europe suggest the exact opposite. Again, it seems counterintuitive, but again, I believe the relationships between the drug users and the staff at Insight have a lot to do with this. While purely anecdotal, I have seen a great resurgence in those that visit Insight. It's like they have realized that somebody actually cares about them. And so, therefore, they want to care about themselves. This is certainly the first step to reclaiming their lives. I think the government should be assisting, not putting up roadblocks when helping communities with problems surrounding the drug issue. Supervised injection sites are not the only answer, but they certainly have a part to play with the street-entrenched drug user. Supervised injection sites hold out the first line of treatment, and we should be doing everything possible to replicate the successes of Insight. We do not support putting up supervised injection sites if all the supports are not in place. We also strongly believe that this is a medical issue and has got to be treated as such. While enforcement is part of every discussion on the drug issue, it should not be weighed more heavily than any other part. We should also use this discussion to talk about more traditional treatment protocols. More detox centers are needed, as well as transitional housing units and long-term treatment centers. This brings me to another dilemma. Why is the government tossing aside the law and the science regarding this issue? Is it based purely on the moral aspect of this issue? Because if this is, they are again wrong. There have been over 2 million injections at Insight with 4,000 medically intervened overdoses, yet not one life has been lost. This goes in face of the Bill C-2's assertion that only one life per year is saved. This brings me to the fact that I surely hold the higher moral ground. I choose to help the most disenfranchised in our communities. The only comparison I can think of is the lepers of biblical times. Their communities also shunned them. But as now, so was it then, and there are some who have chosen to help. So in closing, I will leave you with this. If Jesus were alive today, he certainly, most certainly, would support supervised injection sites. Thank you.
Fine. Thank you very much, Mr. Wilson. I appreciate your
Hi, Doc.
Your your comments here today. And now we will go to Mr. Berner, please.
Honorable members, the Drug Prevention Network of Canada is pleased to support Bill C-2, an act to amend the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act, known as the Respect for Communities Act. So-called safe injection sites, which are hubs for illegal and antisocial behaviors, will not be welcomed by neighborhoods if these operations are simply thrust upon them. Asking the promoters of this failed and woolen-headed experiment to answer some serious questions before building their empire at the expense of local integrities is the very least we can do as a democracy, and we applaud the current administration for this initiative. Let's look at pieces of the bill and at the real evidence, not the questionable studies presented by the very people who built Insight. A report by the BC Centre for Excellence in HIV/AIDS on harm reduction programs and Insight released last summer, for example, is not science. It is public relations. Authors Julio Montaner, Thomas Kerr, and Evan Wood have produced nearly two dozen papers on the use of Insight. They've been awarded more than $18 million of taxpayer money in recent years, and predictably they boast of good results in connecting addicts to treatment, but convincing evidence is not only lacking, it's non-existing. The current campaign reports significant reductions in drug overdoses, yet the government of British Columbia selected vital statistics and health status indicators show, quote, that the number of deaths from drug overdose in Vancouver's downtown east side has increased every year, with one exception, since the site opened in 2003. In addition, the federal government's own advisory committee on drug injection sites report only 5% of drug addicts use the injection site, 3% were referred for treatment, and I believe personally that's terribly high, and there's no indication the crime rate has decreased, as well as no indication of decrease in AIDS and hepatitis C since the injection site was opened. Claims of success for Insight made in The Lancet, the famous British medical journal, in 2011 were challenged vigorously in a 15-page heavily documented response penned by addiction specialists from Australia, the US, and Canada, and by a former VPD officer who worked the downtown east side for years. In a critical evaluation of the effects of safe injection facilities for the Institute on Global Drug Policy, Dr. Garth Davies, who is a Simon Fraser University associate professor, wrote, quote, the methodological and analytical approaches used in these studies are compromised by an array of deficiencies, including a lack of baseline data, insufficient conceptual and operational clarity, inadequate evaluation criteria, absent statistical controls, dearth of longitudinal studies, and inattention to intra-site variation. None of the attributes attributed to SIFs can be unambiguously verified. And here, ladies and gentlemen, is exactly what happened. The three good doctors were originally working on HIV/AIDS, and they did something curious because it had an unintended consequence. They basically resolved the problem of HIV/AIDS in a wonderful way, and their work is magnificent, but they kind of put themselves out of work. So then they turned their attentions to addictions using the same template to get money and to support what they believe and so on and so on. So really, it's really the old journalistic story of follow the money. Now, I had dinner a few months ago with somebody who used to work at Insight, and he said that he had to quit because he thought the place was evil. And I said, well, okay, we're agreed on that, but why did you think it was evil? And he said, because I've actually seen the so-called researchers counting one addict five times. And I've seen this several times. He's also seen so-called researchers interviewing an addict moments after the addict has just shot up. Now, I ask you all, when you leave this committee meeting, please go to the local hospital and go in a room where there's someone in a coma and try to interview them and see what that's like, because that's what you will get when you talk to someone who has just shot up. Dr. Colin Mangum, who is on the board of directors of the Drug Prevention Network of Canada, has been a researcher in this field since 1979. Quote, the proposal for Insight was written by the same people who are evaluating it. This is a clear conflict of interest. Any serious evaluation should be independent. All external critiques or reviews, there are four of them, found profound overstatements and evidence of interpretation bias. all of the evidence on public disorder, overdose deaths, entry into treatment, containment of serum-borne viruses, and so on, is weak or entirely non-existent, and it doesn't support the claims of success. There is every appearance, Dr. Mangum says, of the setting of an agenda before Insight ever started, then a pursuit of that agenda, bending or overstating results wherever necessary. Now let's look at the bill itself. Under item 3, the minister may consider an application, etc., after the following priorities have been established. So I will just turn to two of them. A, scientific evidence demonstrating medical benefit. Well, we submit to you there is no such legitimate, clear, clean, and independent evidence. Quite the contrary, nothing has changed. The very idea that giving addicts a place to shoot up will help them in any manner shows an extraordinary lack of understanding of the issue of addictions. Let me make this very simple and very clear. What do addicts want? Addicts want more. They don't want more tickets to the ball games. They don't want more children. They don't want more bicycles. They don't want more violin lessons. They want more drugs. That's what they want. So an addicted man or woman may inject under a nurse's supervision, but 2 hours later, the same addict is back in the back alley doing what he or she knows how to do. Why? Because the addict life is not about, you know, a quarter of a gram of inert white powder. It's about a culture and a way of living. Item B3 provides information, back to the criteria, the minister may consider an application, etc. If it provides information about access to drug treatment centers, oh, that were so. I happen to know, because of the work that I do, every treatment center in British Columbia and most of them in Canada. And in spite of Mr. Wilson's passionate testimony, let me give you my passionate testimony. I have yet to hear of one addict, one, being referred to a treatment center. Haven't met him, haven't heard of her, don't know their names, because it doesn't happen. And I know all of the people who run treatment centers, and they will all tell you, I've never had an addict being referred from Insight. So you see, Insight is not about recovery. The good doctors who built it actually don't believe in recovery. They think that abstinence is a fantasy. The provincial health authorities don't support abstinence-based recovery, and these are the very people who whisper in the ear of the provincial health minister. All of these people want to give addicts free needles, free crack pipe kits, free heroin, methadone, lessons on winemaking for alcoholics, and comfy places to shoot up. Insight, you have to understand, Insight is the tip of the iceberg. It's the flagship for a very dark philosophy that says this: you, my boy, are hopeless. So we're going to keep you pacified and pray that you might not break into our condos and cars. You can see how this arrogant and misguided approach is working, how elegantly it fails to enhance the lives of either addicts or communities. The sad truth, ladies and gentlemen, is this. In my province, the poor get methadone and the rich get private treatment clinics. I happen to work at one of those rich private treatment clinics. Number I3, the presence of inappropriately discarded drug litter. Well, I have a friend who owns a building in the downtown east side. She's trying to run a business there, and she has been fighting with the city of Vancouver for 2 years. Would you please remove those damn blue boxes from the back alley? And the city says, no, that's where the addicts are going to throw their needles. Well, I don't know if you're aware of this, but I don't know of any addicts who are up for Good Housekeeping Awards. So my friend who owns this building and is trying to conduct a regular business down there regularly has needles all over the place and human body waste. So you ask communities if they're ready for that. Are they prepared to host that kind of lunacy? And ask the good doctors who've promoted this madness to establish one of their projects next to their homes. Finally, I want to make a comment about two opponents' responses in the House. The Honorable Judy, you have to help me, I don't know how to pronounce her name, Scrow? Whatever her last name is, she's a Liberal from York West, said when this was being debated in the House. The only success I've seen so far, which is limited, is the safe injection site in Vancouver. Well, the good member is right. Her views are extremely limited because all she has to do is go to any city in Canada, and there are hundreds and hundreds of wonderful prevention and treatment programs operating. Not as many as we could have, but there are many of them. So if that's the only thing she's seen, that's the only thing she's seen. And then the Honorable Libby Davies, the NDP for Vancouver.
Mr. Berner, I'm sorry, but your time is up, sir. You're over your opening time. Your comments, perhaps in discussion with Ms. Davies, you can make your point. But we will now go to our third witness, Mr. Thompson. Please, you're up to 10 minutes.
Good afternoon, honorable members, and thank you for the opportunity to speak here today on behalf of Chief Constable Jim Chu in the Vancouver Police Department. Part of my background is I'm in my 34th year of combined policing service as a current member of the Vancouver Police Department and a former member of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. In 2003, I was part of the Vancouver Coastal Health Project team for the Supervised Injection Site, or SIS. In 2003, I was also the author of the Vancouver Police Department's policing and operational plans for the SIS. I also developed and delivered the SIS orientation packages to both VPD members as well as Vancouver Coastal Health staff. I was then on the ground in the downtown east side for the first year of the supervised injection site's operation. Currently, I'm in charge of Vancouver's Northwest Police District, which encompasses the downtown core, West End, and includes our city's entertainment district, and it also has the Dr. Peter Center located in my district. For the VPD, the story of the SIS began back in early 2002. Philip Owen was the mayor and the chair of the Vancouver Police Board at the time. The VPD examined the question of an SIS during a facilitated managerial and executive process and came to two conclusions. One, our expertise is in policing and public safety, not in health and medical research. Therefore, we should always be cautious when and if we choose to support or criticize public health initiatives and or research, given our expertise lies elsewhere. And two, regardless of whether we agree with the concept of an SIS or not, we need to be at the table. As you likely know, in late 2002, a civic election in Vancouver resulted in Larry Campbell, now Senator Campbell, becoming mayor. The primary election issue was the SIS, and Mayor Campbell and others subsequently drove the process to make this concept become a reality. As part of the application process for an exemption under the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act for medical research at the SIS, Health Canada asked the VPD what its position was. We replied that if a drug user is not engaged in disorderly, unlawful, threatening, and/or violent behavior on the street, or wanted for an outstanding arrest warrant, it is unlikely they would be prevented or impeded by the Vancouver Police from accessing the supervised injection site. Just before the SIS opened, the VPD operations plan stated the following to Vancouver police officers. A, police members have a broad range of discretion when dealing with drug use and drug possession in the City of Vancouver. This discretion includes options such as seizure of the drug and or arrest and charging of the person. This discretion lies solely with the police officer on the street. And when dealing with an intravenous drug user found using drugs within a four-block radius of the SIS, it is recommended that our members direct the drug user to attend the SIS to avoid a future contact with the police. Our orientation package for the SIS staff and later for our VPD drug policy stated simply, on a fundamental level, all health initiatives must be lawful. I submit that during the past 11 years, members of the Vancouver Police Department have performed their duties in an exemplary manner in relation to the supervised injection site. And this performance represents the best traditions of a neutral, apolitical, and professional police service in a free and democratic society. Which brings me to the position of the Vancouver Police Department and the key messages I've been asked to deliver to you today. Firstly, the VPD agrees with the Canadian Association of Chiefs of Police position that illicit drugs are harmful. The high incidence of addiction in Vancouver contributes to an inordinately high property crime rate. When the supervised injection site opened, the VPD position was that we were in favor of any legal measure that might have a chance of reducing the drug problem in Vancouver's downtown east side. We are on the record as initially supporting the SIS as a research project and have continued to have a good and effective working relationship with the staff of this facility over the years. The VPD's primary interest and mandate around the SIS has always been and remains public safety, not public health. Our position is as a police agency focused on public safety, it would be inappropriate for the VPD to comment on the medical merits of the SIS. What we will say, based on our decade of experience, is that local civic government and community support, as well as support of the police, are crucial when any new health service is implemented, be it an injection service, a medical clinic, medical health treatment center, or supported housing. And our experience after working with public health, medical and addiction services, and in more recent years, mental health services, is that the police and health services should work toward building effective partnerships that can contribute to and improve the delivery of health services as well as public safety. As to the as to whether we can comment that crime has increased or decreased related specifically to the SAS, we cannot say either way. The SAS is located in a neighborhood with high violent crime caused by many factors, none of which are specifically related to the SAS. Property crime in the neighborhood is also driven by drug addiction and again cannot be specifically related to the SAS. Upon request, we have provided information regarding our historical SIS operational policing plans to the police services of other cities. We are conscious, however, that every city, town, and community will have their own circumstances and stories, and that the situation in Vancouver may be, well, quite different. In closing, the Vancouver Police Department will not be an active participant in any debate about the medical merits of a supervised injection site, particularly in relation to other cities and jurisdictions in Canada. Thank you.
Fine. Thank you very much, Mr. Thompson. We will now, and our other guests, we will now go to a round of questioning, and we will start off 7 minutes. Mr. Falk, please, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to start off by thanking our witnesses for their presentations here this afternoon. Mr. Wilson, I'd like to ask you a few questions, if I may. What is your connection with Insight? Are you an employee there?
No, I was one of the plaintiffs in all three court cases. I was just an addict who was part of the Vancouver Area Network of Drug Users, which is a political sort of trying to better our lives, get more treatment. Actually, is one of the big things we try to do. And the city of Vancouver sent me to Frankfurt in Germany to take a look at the six there. I came back. I thought it was a good idea as long as the other supports were in place. And I used Insight contrary to Mr. Berner's testimony. And many people have gone out to Maple Ridge Treatment Center from Insight, and I've got 5 years of sobriety because of that.
Okay, and I do want to commend you on your 5 years of sobriety.
Thank you very much, sir. I'm very proud of it.
And you should be. You referenced my best friend Jesus in the end of your treatise here.
Yes, sir.
And you seem to infer that you know what he would do. And I'm not so bold as I would make a statement like this, but I do know in reading the scriptures that Jesus, when he encountered activities that were illegal and illicit, never condoned them, never.
No, I wouldn't.
But he did meet with the lepers of the world, and he did meet with the people that were tax cheats, and he did meet with the adulteresses of the world, and he always left them with one thing: go and sin no more, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I don't see anywhere in Scripture that would support your statement. Anyway, I'm going to read you something here.
Yes, sir.
The Supreme Court of Canada rendered a decision regarding Insight. And you know what? I want to make a general statement here. I'm a little disappointed in a couple of the presentations I heard here today, because they're defending or arguing against the merits of Insight, and I don't think that's what we're doing here today. We're talking about Bill C-2, which is protecting communities.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Respecting and protecting communities. And the Supreme Court rendered a decision about Insight as a supervised injection site. The court affirmed the discretionary power of the minister to grant exemptions, but stated that decisions must be made in accordance with the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms and balance public health and safety concerns. The court specified factors that the minister must consider when assessing an application for a supervised injection site. These include that any evidence related to the impact of a site on crime rates, local conditions indicating a need for such a site, the regulatory structure in place to support the facility, resources available to support its maintenance, and expressions of community support or opposition. My question to you, Mr. Wilson, would be, is it reasonable for the government to require community input on proposals to establish injection sites, especially given the Supreme Court's ruling that the minister must consider such views?
I think it's really important that the community have a say. And our community did have a say. And we have 12,000 addicts down there. And I'm telling you, sir, nobody wants to be doing or sinning by doing drugs down there. They all want treatment. But there isn't any treatment because the government doesn't fund enough treatment. We have 12,000 people in Vancouver, in downtown Vancouver. Okay. Just met 12,000 people. And we have 42 detox beds, sir. How do we get out of this problem? Okay. How do we do it?
Yeah. I've heard from some of the other witnesses that there are treatment facilities available, and so my question was very straightforward. Is it reasonable for the government to require community input? And you indicated that it is.
I think it's okay. Very important.
And so that's fair.
Yep.
Mr. Berner, I would like to direct a question at you as well. You seem to be supportive of the legislation as it is written, although I don't think you really address the legislation. Which would ensure communities through a variety of different avenues that would ensure
legislation, sir,
through a variety of different avenues are consulted before an application would go forward to the minister. Would you support that?
Absolutely. I quoted the legislation. That's why I quoted it. I believe that communities should be consulted. Mr. Falk, you're dealing with a problem here that you may not be aware of, and that is that health authorities and many medical people are extraordinarily arrogant, and they will say, yeah, go ahead and consult communities, but we know better because we're the doctors.
You didn't.
So I support the bill, and I support that you must go. If the city of Abbotsford, the city of Laval, any city in Canada wants to have one of these places, let's go to them and say, okay, here's some information. Do you want this on your street corner? And my guess would be 99% of them would say get lost. And that would be a healthy response.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Berner. And Inspector Thompson, do you think it's reasonable, the 27 criteria that the minister needs to consider in granting an exception? Do you think it's that the criteria in the bill is reasonable?
Well, I think that one of these, when I've spoken, I'll actually frame this in the context of past discussions I've had with other police services and other, I'll call them advocates across the country and other cities. And one of my first questions has always been, does local government support, you know, a service such as an injection service? And, you know, my experience and my opinion has been basically that without that support, which is, you know, fundamental to in a democracy, really you have an uphill battle in terms of implementing a service. So I look at the bill, and certainly you'd want the community's input, you would want input from the police. Those things are all quite reasonable. Because ultimately, as I've said, it, at some levels locally, it's a political decision. And in Vancouver, you have to remember, back in 2002, we had three civic parties in that election. All three of them supported the SIS. The party that came out on top were the most vigorous in their support, but all three were saying that they would implement a SIS. So again, the voters of Vancouver at that time were not choosing, and we had a very high voter turnout, were not choosing one side or the other. Basically, all sides of the question were supporting having such a facility open.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Thompson, we will now go to Mr. Davies, please, 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. And first of all, to you, Dean, I welcome you to Ottawa. I'm very proud to have you here as a constituent from the Downtown East Side. You're really kind of a hero in our community for the years of work that you've put in.
Thank you.
Following these cases, being involved in Vandu, I know it's been really hard on you personally sometimes, but you've always stuck with it. Mm-hmm. And so I just want to say I'm really proud for the work that you've done and that you're here today.
I'm still alive to be here.
Because it's not necessarily an easy thing to deal with, as you've heard. And I'm really sorry that you've had to listen to Mr. Berner and really just how he demonizes drug users and insight with just so much information.
I've been listening to David for years.
I do think that Mr. Falk is correct in one point, and that is we are here debating C2, the bill, and whether or not this bill meets the test of the Supreme Court of Canada. I remember you were at the Supreme Court of Canada the day the decision came down, and you've been involved in this for a very long time. So one question I have, because you have followed it so closely, and never mind all the studies. I mean, as you say, there's overwhelming studies that support insight, but obviously some people will never, ever believe the evidence before them. But at the end of the day, you're someone who has direct experience, not only in the process. You know how much we went through in Vancouver. There was a lot of public consultation, and sometimes it was really tough going, really tough going, and there was a lot of opposition. But I would say at the end of the day, you know, by and large, most people now support it. They see insight as part of the solution, not part of the problem. So looking at this bill and what you can see and knowing what we went through the first time around, do you think that this bill will allow any other safe injection site in Canada? Like, what does it look like to you in terms of the process that's laid out here?
Well, I find it really interesting. I just want to say, so a week ago, I was out at this dinner date thing, and who arrived out of the blue but Judge Pitfield from the very first decision at the BC Supreme Court, most conservative judge in British Columbia, and he sat down beside me, and I said, Judge, and he said, Mr. Wilson, he laughed. And I put to him, I said, when did you decide that this was going to be a legit thing? And he said, do you remember in the first hour of the trial when I asked the opposition, was this a medical issue? And they hummed and hawed, and he said, again, is this a medical issue? And they said, yes. He said, I decided right then the next 2 days did not matter. I believe that this Bill C-2 will put too many fingers in the pie, whatever, too many people that can stop it on nothing but a whim of a moral judgment. And I don't think that's right. I think that the Supreme, 9-0, 9 Supreme Court justices stated that this was a medical issue. It should be treated as such. It was framed within Canada's laws. The people inside that building are not breaking any Canadian law. And that if we allow anybody to have a say, and who don't have an actual participation within the thing, if you go to any city in this where there's a lot of drug addicts around, you're going to see those people wanting a solution. And I'm saying that I believe supervised injection sites are a beginning solution to the problem. It's not the end all. It's not the be all. In fact, it's probably the only first 20 or 30 minutes of the change of my life is that injection. There's a lot after that. But if we don't give those persons that first 20 minutes, where are they going to go?
Well, thank you very much. I think sometimes there's an impression left that somehow insight just, you know, came out of nowhere. But in actual fact, there was a process already under the Controlled Drug and Substances Act that gave the minister discretion to allow an exemption. And so it's not like there was a vacuum. There already was a process.
Exactly.
Insight had to follow that. Now, Insight just got recently had its renewal, which is good, and I'm not sure for how many years it is. But if what's your opinion in terms of whether or not Insight had to come under this bill? What the chances are that it would actually be approved? Do you think that all of the criteria, the 26 criteria, in fact, there's additional ones if you're existing, plus the principles? What hope do you think there is that it would be approved?
It'd be as dead as those four addicts that could have used Insight last week in Vancouver who died.
Okay, thank you. And if I could, do I have a little bit of time to ask?
Okay. You have about just a little less than 2 minutes.
Okay, if I could ask Inspector Thompson, I was reading the province newspaper, I happened to read an article a while ago where the Vancouver Police Department was issuing an advisory about some really bad drugs that were on the street and were urging people to go to Insight. And again, unfortunately, we've had a lot of misinformation from other police representatives at the committee. But I just wanted to ask you, is it fairly routine that the Vancouver Police Department and the officers on the beat do encourage people to use Insight, and that when there are some really awful things going on in terms of what's on the street, that they actually put out even a public advisory and encourage people to go to Insight? Is that something that's fairly routine?
It would be. We've got a very close working relationship with Insight. Frankly, we, in this last crisis where, and there's still an active investigation, but this last crisis, we certainly worked with Insight to get the word out on the street about the bad dope, and it was a crucial part of our communication strategy, because again, we can put something out via the media, but for this very marginalized population, will they actually hear that on the, over the media? They will more likely hear it and or and also maybe listen more closely to someone who's working at that level in the Insight.
Okay.
So, yeah, they're a crucial part of any strategy we would have.
Okay. Thanks very much. And now we'll go to Mr. Carmichael, please. 7 minutes, sir.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to our witnesses today. And, Mr. Wilson, I'd like to begin with you. First of all, you started off mentioning how nervous you were. Congratulations. You did it. You got through it. Well
thank
done.
You. Thank you.
And I also want to congratulate you on 5 years of sobriety.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask you a question. Because C2 focuses so much on the consultative process around community input into whether a consumption site, injection site, should be located in a community. In your opinion, should community views be considered in the application process of these injection sites?
Well, what do you mean by community? Like, if you're talking
should
about...
Let's say that somebody mentioned Abbotsford.
Yeah.
Let's say a group goes to Abbotsford and they want to find a way to develop a center similar to Insight in the Abbotsford community. Mm-hmm. Should the community, should the families, the people that live within the neighborhoods where the establishing group might want to locate, should they have input location?
I think for sure, but everybody's opinion should be not weighted anymore, no more than the doctor's opinion, no more than the police's opinion.
Yeah, no, I hear you on the medical side.
Okay.
Just from a consultative process, should the families, though, the people, the community that are going to be inheriting this new facility have the opportunity to accept or reject it based on criteria?
I think that's a tough question to ask me because, sir, if those people are ignorant about the facts and the way that drug addicts are demonized within the media, such as David Berner's programs on television every week, then we don't have a chance, sir. We wouldn't have a chance because we're demonized in the media and we don't have a recourse for that. And so most people in those communities think we're a bunch of horrible people that only want to rob them and everything else. That's if that's the community you're talking about, then I say no, because unless
they're
educated.
I'm talking about the community in general. Everybody's got to have input.
Okay.
So if you're going to come into my city or into somebody else's city and,
yes, the
and establish them, we've got to hear all sides.
Yes,
and
all
somebody's
sides.
Got to adjudicate that and say yay or nay based
okay,
on
but
that.
Yes, the community should have a say. Yes, sir.
Okay. So with that, Mr. Berner, last week we heard testimony that talked about the area around Insight specifically and that went out several blocks, and they talked about, to your comment, inappropriately discarded drug litter. We heard discussion about comments about attracting a drug trade down into that area that basically centered within blocks of the Insight facility. And I guess from your perspective, when we start talking about the criteria that's involved in establishing one of these sites or that the minister has to make a decision, I wonder if you could, from your view, are the requirements for the criteria of the information to be put forward to the Minister of Health too onerous, or do they strike a balance to ensure the community has been adequately consulted? And I'm thinking of testimony we've heard previously, which I would think you might have read, but maybe you could just comment on that, sir.
I don't think they're too onerous. I think there are a couple of minor details that could use some massaging, like if someone's going to work at a facility, we have to know that they've been clear of any police activity for 10 years. I think that's too onerous because often the best people in working with addicts are recovering and recovered addicts who've been clean and sober for 3 months or 6 months. Or I once hired a guy from California, and I had to get special special permission from a then conservative government to bring him in to Canada. I don't think they're too onerous. But let me say something about my testimony. People are sitting here saying that I demonize addicts. A, I created the first treatment center in Canada in 1967, and B, I work with addicts every week. I have people in my arms weeping, working on their trauma. I don't demonize addicts. I have helped thousands of addicts get clean and sober. It's very easy for the Libby Davies and the Wilsons of the world to sit there and say, oh yeah, he's just a guy who demonizes addicts. That's dreadful.
Bernard, I've got limited time here, and I don't want to create a confrontation beyond what we already have. So from your perspective, do you think that the criteria that we've been given adequately react to the Supreme Court ruling of criteria that must be considered when you look at the 27?
Yes, I do.
Criteria.
I've read through it thoroughly, and I think it's quite reasonable.
Okay, thank you very
You're
much.
You're asking for... Okay.
Yeah, no, I just... We're limited time. What is my time left?
Still have another minute and a half,
sir. Minute and a half. So that's... Mr. Thompson, over to you for a minute and a half. If a community were to uniformly reject a proposal to establish a supervised injection site, how would you propose that the minister react to that and go forward?
I commented earlier, I think at some levels it really hinges on local government support. Insight would not have happened had it not been for the support of City Council and the Mayor, and both the previous administration and then Mayor Campbell's administration. So really, at some levels, if the community rejects it and the local political support is not there for a facility, then yes, it would be a very tough road to take around basically bringing in a site, because you really do need... What happened in Vancouver is you had the citizens of Vancouver, in many ways, accepted that this was something that should be tried. So again, you would have to always look at that local support.
So last question then to Mr. Thompson. Then from your perspective, in your opinion, do the criteria that we've been provided, the 27 points of criteria, adequately react to the Supreme Court ruling of criteria that must be considered, in your opinion?
My opinion, my only concern is the bar been raised too high? And I mean, those are clearly criteria that are important, but has the bar been raised so high that it'd be very difficult to bring in any sort of facility? Again, much of our focus in the VPD these last few years has also been looking at mental health and facilities and so on, supported housing. And there has to be a consultative process around that. But ultimately, at some levels, if there is a ongoing medical public health issue, sometimes the tough decisions need to be made around both that constituency, but obviously the people nearby. Part of our role from a policing standpoint is to assist and work together with that to deal with the public safety concerns that may arise out of such a facility being open in any given location. And again,
Thank you, Mr. Thompson, and thank you, Mr. Carmichael. We will now go to Mrs. Fry, please.
Dean, you did a great job, and I want to congratulate you on the work you have been doing to bring this to the fore and to...
Microphone, please.
Everyone who sees you knows that it's possible.
It is possible.
For someone to benefit from a safe injection site.
You remember me 15 years ago?
Pardon?
I said, you remember me 15 years ago? If anybody saw me then and now...
Yes, indeed. I think it's good that we're focusing here on the bill itself and whether the bill is adequate or it isn't adequate or it goes too far or it doesn't go too far. And so I just wanted to ask you a question. The Supreme Court, I'm reading the decision now here, says that the minister must consider whether denying an exemption would cause deprivations of life and security of the person that are not in accordance with the principles of fundamental justice. So that the minister must always balance the Charter rights and Section 7 of the Charter with factors deciding whether the impact of such a facility has on crime rates. And I think it's absolutely appropriate for the police to be giving some kind of information on that. Whether the local conditions indicate a need for such a supervised inspection site, and that's a public health decision on what is the evidence in terms of HIV, AIDS, hepatitis C, et cetera, just as the police can talk about crime. I think the regulatory structure in place, that's all fine. The Supreme Court talks about it to support the facility. And the resources available to support its maintenance. And that comes from the provincial minister of health and the municipality that basically says, do they have these support systems in place? So what we see is that there are about, and of course community support, there are about five pieces. I see them as five criteria, not 26 or 27. Because if the provincial minister of health knows that the provincial minister of health has all of that, it is up to the provincial minister of health to say so and to also go ahead and hire the people that's going to do this work, et cetera, et cetera. And so my question to you is, it's not that I know you don't disagree with these five factors, but do you believe that they actually are too interventionist and go too far?
I'm going to reiterate what Inspector Scott Thompson just said. It's raising the bar so high that it will never get done. And I think that if you read the judgment of the Supreme Court, you know, they again framed it. They said that, you know, our right to health has to be balanced with that right of the laws of Canada. And if you went in the downtown east side and saw those 4,000 to 12,000, whatever the number is, 4,000 to 12,000 addicts, you would say, my goodness, we need the supervised injection site because this health is bad. It's deteriorating daily. And as Scott says, you know, with the law, they're working with us there. I just think that the new Bill C-2 is going to put the bar so high that we'll never be able to have other communities try to use this. It's not the answer in every city,
no.
But it's in some place. I know a place in Toronto where it's needed. I know a place in Montreal where it could be used. Those are just two cities that I've been to. I don't know if Abbotsford needs one right at the moment, but I think that if places like Toronto and Montreal where there's certain neighborhoods, and I'm sure the community there would say, yes, let's try something because everything else doesn't work.
And I think there was a great deal of public consultation. I mean, I was there. I was,
exactly.
As I said, the minister responsible for the downtown east side at the time, just for this particular area, and found that out. I just wanted to ask Mr. Berner a question. Mr. Berner, you talk about conflict of interest by doctors, by the Miss Dr. Montana and the others who did this particular project. Do you think that there is conflict of interest when the minister who brought forward this bill, the day it was introduced, the party to which the minister belongs, sent out a fundraising letter saying, we are bringing forward this bill so we could stop all those junkies from hanging around in your neighborhood? Do you think that's a conflict of interest? That's my first question. The second question is, do you believe that... you run a treatment center, you say, and it's a private treatment center, and so you make money out of that. Do you believe that that is a conflict of interest, the fact that insight may, in fact, cause governments to try and put public treatment centers as opposed to private treatment centers? Do you think those are conflicts of interest? Because you seem to know a lot about conflict of interest, Mr. Berner.
Yeah, let me answer your second question first. I don't run a private treatment center. I work at a private treatment center, and I know many of the... May I answer before you start? And I know many of the nonprofit treatment centers, and I often work with them, and that is not a conflict of interest. My interest is in supporting prevention and treatment. That's my interest. And as for your first question, I'm not prepared to do your politicking for you, Dr. Fry. You do it yourself.
Sorry that you couldn't answer that question, and you seem to know so much about conflict of interest. I'm really sorry. I would like to then talk about the VPD, because I think that the Vancouver Police Department, you're sending people, if you find there's a problem in terms of street drugs, and you're sending people to Insight. Actually, when I traveled in Switzerland and in Germany, looking at some of the Insights that had started there, the police, we talked to the police, we went on the street with the police, and they actually did the same thing. when they found out that there was a real problem that could harm addicts on the street or people who were using, especially intravenous drugs, they immediately referred them to those safe injection sites. And I think that is an attempt at reducing harm to a person. And so, you know, what you say that you have been doing, I want to congratulate you on it, because I think it's really important that police are not only there to find out the criminals, but you are there to protect people, and that's a really solid source of protection. I know that you've agreed with me somewhat that the list of criteria is so overwhelming that no one would be able to meet them. But can you tell me a little bit about what the drug scene was like in Vancouver and what it is like in that little bubble now?
We'll have to wait for a response at another time. Okay. We will now go to Mrs. Durelle.
Sorry about that, Scott.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I would like to thank the witnesses with us today. That's all right. I'll start. Please take your time, Mr. Wilson, to put on your earbud. I'll start with Mr. Thompson. I have a quick question. I come from Montreal, and local community organizations have worked with Montreal's police services, the mayor of the city, and Quebec's government. They put out a report in 2011, which was a feasibility study on implementing local supervised injection services in Montreal, and they all agreed, and they were all consulted to have a supervised injection site in Montreal that was part of the homelessness strategy in Montreal. My question is, did you hear about the proposed project in Montreal, and what do you think of that project if you are aware of it?
I'm frankly, I'd be reluctant to comment because I don't know the details. As I did say in my testimony, we're reluctant to comment because every city, every town has their own issues and concerns. And really, it's in our view, it's not. We're familiar with Vancouver. We're reluctant to comment about other cities and what they come up with, because frankly, it's really up to them, a given city, Montreal in this case, to make their own decisions and go through their own process. They can ask us questions. I've certainly shared with the Montreal Police our operational and policing plans for SIS from 2003 to hopefully assist them if they ever were to have to go down that path to provide public safety services, around a given site.
Merci beaucoup, Mr. Thompson.
Thank you very much, Mr. Thompson. Mr. Wilson, thank you very much for being here, and congratulations on your 5 years of sobriety. It is a real pleasure to have you here today. Do you have any comments on the fact that Montreal's police services, the mayor, and Quebec's government, as well as local community organizations, have agreed on the idea of a supervised injection site in Montreal? What do you think of that situation?
I totally agree. I've actually worked with CACTUS, the group of people that are investigating, putting in, I guess the government has asked CACTUS to be the front line people in Montreal. I've been out to Montreal numerous times and worked with CACTUS. I think, one only has to go up to Saint-Hubert Street to realize that they'd be a perfect place to have a supervised injection site. And I think they're doing the right thing. And I also believe that one of the things they're looking at, the mobile unit, is an extraordinarily good idea, because that way you could, if there was all of a sudden an area that was overrun by, I guess, the drug issue, you could go in there and put a stopgap measure in there right away while you build up other services around it. Mm-hmm. It's really important to get the people involved at that level. People on the streets are so paranoid of it's funny, they've changed their ideas of the police in Vancouver because of people like Scott Thompson and his crew. But they're so paranoid about police and the government and everything. Just all they want to do is put them in jail or whatever. They don't want to help them, that it's very, very hard to get to those people. So a mobile unit, I think, would be an incredibly good way of getting people involved into the medical aspect of their addiction. You know, it took me 30 years to walk through those doors and finally say, I can't do this. I need help. And I tried many other times, and usually there was about a 2 or 3 week wait, and by that time my circumstances had changed and I had to leave. I had left the whatever. So I think what Montreal is doing is a really good idea, and the whole Quebec government.
Merci. Je vais y aller rapidement.
Thank you. I will quickly ask another question. In Montreal, 68% of drug users have hepatitis C. Do you think that people who have hepatitis C in Montreal could benefit from this type of service, whether it be a mobile unit or a fixed site?
Yes, I am one of those 68% myself who has hepatitis C. I actually won the HIV lottery, as I call it. But yes, because one of the things about HCV rather than HIV is that, you know, the disease model is longer, it's more chronic, it's going to cost the government. If they think HIV's been a real health hazard, wait till HCV starts hitting the neighborhoods, and it travels through communities a lot faster than the HIV. It's going to be a health catastrophe. And yet, if we had a mobile van or something like that, we could start teaching these people that how to deal with the illness.
Mr. Wilson, and certainly to our witnesses today, Mr. Wilson, Mr. Thompson, Mr. Brunner, thank you so kindly for coming in today. The chair will excuse you now, but just before the chair suspends for the other witnesses, I will bring to the committee's attention for deliberation. The chair has received a submission and some follow-up information from Mrs. Landau's testimony, but it is not translated. So it is sitting here, and it is in the possession of the chair and will stay there until the chair has some, either until it is translated and or then the chair has some direction. So we will now suspend briefly while we ask our other witnesses to come forward.
Thank you.
For the second hour, we'll be a little bit less, though. We apologize for the short delay. We had some challenges with the video conference, but we're all hooked up and live now. And so the chair, on behalf of the committee, would like to invite our witnesses, of course, to make a brief statement, up to 10 minutes and hopefully less. And then after that, we will open the floor to questioning. With us for the second hour, we have from the Pivot Legal Society, Adrian Smith, Health and Drug Policy Staff Lawyer. Welcome. And from the Society of Accredited Senior Agents, we have Barry Lebeau, founder. And by video conference from Vancouver, we have from the Canadian Drug Policy Coalition, Donald McPherson, the Executive Director. So, and of course, and we have Tom Stack. How could I miss Mr. Stamatakis? Excuse me, from the Toronto Police Service as well, we have Mr. Stamatakis. Did I get that one right? Canadian Police Association. Canadian Police Association. My apologies again, sir. Well, I guess I should have turned the sheet over. There we are. Okay, well, anyways, welcome. So we will take it in order of introduction. So we will first start off, please, with Adrian Smith. Opening.
Thank you, Chairperson, honorable members. I'd like to begin by saying that this is a bad bill. From a legal perspective, the bill is a hyperbolic response to a settled point of law. It will likely not withstand constitutional scrutiny, and it invites an expensive and pointless charter challenge. As a representative of the Pivot Legal Society, an organization that uses the law to address the root causes of poverty and marginalization in Canada, I must say that this bill will restrict access to a proven health care service, which will result in needless human suffering for some of the most vulnerable Canadians. I would like to use some of my time to correct something that the Minister of Health said in her remarks on Monday. She spoke about the necessity of this bill, and she said that Bill C-2 was required because of the Supreme Court of Canada's decision. With respect, the Minister is mistaken. I propose to briefly outline what the Supreme Court of Canada said to show that Bill C-2 is a significant departure from the guidance of the court, and to outline finally some of the consequences of this bill's coming into force. I don't believe this committee needs background about the Controlled Drug and Substances Act, but I should say that it is a blanket criminal law. Exemptions under Section 56 suspend the action of that law for certain purposes, and it's in this exemption that Insight currently exists. In a 56 exemption, the law is suspended.
And not as the Minister of Public Safety said last week. This is an area where drug users, this is not an area where drug users can do something legal. Technically, the law is suspended and no one is transgressing it.
What the Supreme Court of Canada actually said in PHS in Canada, which is the court case about this section, there were a number of very, very clear findings. And the first is that supervised injection service is a health service, that people who inject drugs are exposed to a number of harms as a result of their illness to the extent that their charter rights are engaged. The Controlled Drug and Substance Act, as we've heard many times, has a dual purpose. One is protecting public health and the other is to protect public safety. The minister's discretion must be exercised within the parameters of the charter, and she must balance this dual purpose. In the context of Insight, and significantly, this is the point of the PHS decision, when there is not evidence of a public safety threat, an exemption must generally be granted. They're presumptive, nearly. And to ensure that the minister, in her discretion and balancing, did not lead to arbitrary decision-making, there were five permissive factors, which are very narrow, and the minister must consider them if they are available. That is all that is required. What Bill C-2 does is a significant departure from that. It answers the requirement that exemptions be generally granted that the court directed with a presumption in the bill that exemptions will generally be withheld. It ignores the requirement that the CDSA is a balancing bill that requires aspects of public health and public safety by framing the question of supervised injection service as a narrow threat, as a narrow public safety issue, and only in a negative way. It also expands the court's five permissive factors into 26 impossible criteria, which will lead to a limiting of the availability of this necessary health service. So with respect, Bill C-2 is more about this federal government's distaste for this kind of health service than it is about anything the court said. The results of this are problematic and unconstitutional. The effect of Bill C-2 will be to frustrate the application process for health care providers. It will be to restrict access to supervised injection services and approvals for future centers. And for reasons which are set out in my brief, which are before you, and for those following at home, can be downloaded from the Parliament website, the bill perpetrates a number of head-on assaults to other constitutional provisions, which are the legal backbone of this nation. This is important for two reasons. There are two sets of consequences that will flow from this bill, and the first are legal. Bill C-2 will not withstand constitutional scrutiny. It will invite an expensive and pointless charter challenge and a long series of litigations on a point of law which is already settled under a legislative framework that is arguably worse than the one that the Supreme Court of Canada condemned. If the Insight decision was a question about how charter rights of drug users were violated by an initiative to prevent access to supervised injection services, it is difficult to see how this is not exactly the same thing. But the second public health outcome of Bill C-2 is arguably more important. Passing Bill C-2 will have a devastating and unconscionable consequences for the most vulnerable Canadians who are members of our community. The barriers the bill presents to accessing life-saving health care will allow a heartbreaking public health emergency to continue under a law and order agenda and expose patients and communities to infection, to suffering, and to death. I live three blocks away from Insight in Vancouver's downtown east side. And on Thanksgiving weekend, when healthier Canadians were sitting down eating their turkey suppers, a narcotic opioid drug called fentanyl was being passed off by street dealers as heroin. It is indistinguishable to users, but it is an order of magnitude more powerful than heroin. And as a result, on Thanksgiving Monday, there were 10 overdoses. On the Sunday before, there were 16. There were 5 the following day, all of these at Insight. Nobody who overdosed at Insight died. Unfortunately, some people did die. I understood it was 2. One was a young woman. One was a man named Tony Snakeskin. I hear from my colleague, Mr. Wilson, there were in fact 4. These people died because they were alone and they did not have access to medical care. This is a question not just for Vancouver, but for all of our communities. In the summer of 2014, the Agence de la Santé des Services Sociaux de Montréal investigated 83 cases of overdose. 25 of them were fatal. In other neighborhoods across the country, thousands of people have died, and countless more will die if they do not have the access to supervised injection services, which the court said was required. So to conclude, I will say that Bill C-2 is contrary to what the court ordered. It is unconstitutional, and it will allow people to die. Alors, comme je viens de vous dire en anglais, le ministre de Santé...
As I just said in English, the Minister of Health said that the Supreme Court of Canada's decision in the Attorney General of Canada versus PHS requires the passage of Bill C-2. With respect, that is not correct. What the decision said is that the Charter protects drug users' rights and that the Minister must grant exceptions allowing supervised consumption sites. Bill C-2 is inviting pointless legal challenges because the government finds this type of care to be intolerable. In the meantime, our neighbors are going to lose their lives. That is unconstitutional and unconscionable.
Quietly that the federal government does not value the lives of people who use drugs and people whose lives would be saved by this service. Now, subject to your questions, those are my submissions.
Thank you very much, Ms. Smith. Now we will go to Mr. LeBeau.
Yes.
Your answer.
Mr. Chairman, honorable members, my role today is to speak from a real estate perspective about depreciation and stigma. My name's Barry Lebo. I'm from Toronto. I've been a real estate professional since 1968. This is my 47th year in real estate. I'll dispense with, of course, my CV and everything, but I've testified over 500 trials, a large percentage of those, and across Canada and the United States. A large percentage of those have been on real estate depreciation and stigma cases in the years that I was an active appraiser. Whereas about 10% of the cases actually made it to court, most settled, I've probably written thousands of reports that have gone to courts around the world on this subject. I have been awarded the Meritorious Award for my lifetime achievement in real estate by the Toronto chapter of the Toronto of the Real Estate Institute of Canada some years ago, and I've obtained 14 designations in real estate, four of which are dealing with appraisal. And I retired from the appraisal profession full-time after 30 years as a member of the Appraisal Institute of Canada. So today, I basically spend most of my time working with seniors in Canada from a real estate perspective, and I'm the founder of the Accredited Senior Agent Designation Program for Canadians, which has now reached about 3,000 realtors coast to coast. So in my years as an appraiser in 1980, the Hazardous Products Act, we banned urea formaldehyde in Canada. And what does that have to do with this? About 80 to 100,000 homes were affected by UFI in Canada, and most people were in a panic because they believed their houses were going to lose value. The courts have found, especially in Quebec, that there has been no scientific proof that UFI caused health concerns, but go tell that to people who have houses with urea formaldehyde. They believe it, buyers believe it. So what I had to do in the early years, and that's how I got involved with this, is no footprints in the snow, working with CMHC on advisory capacity to figure out how to do it, what was the loss in value when people had urea formaldehyde, and what was the stigma effect even if they had it removed. So eventually, houses did sell. I tracked over thousands of homes across southern Ontario, and eventually I did about 1,000 cases of urea formaldehyde, about 70 of which went to court, different courts in the province of Ontario. So I found myself in a new vocation, stigma. And by default, stigma basically is a theory. It's simple. It's a depreciation that lingers after something is cured. So with that said, I always joke that I'm probably the leader in stigma in Canada because no one else wants to specialize in this type of field. And with that said, I've lectured across and done cases such as asbestos, all kinds of oil and other types of contamination, suicide, murder, and yes, haunted houses. And I have a course called Selling the Haunted House, or the Impact of Stigma on Real Estate, which teaches real estate agents what to disclose to the buyers. Now, haunting. You'll say, why does haunting have to do anything about this? One of the most famous cases that we have in North America was the Ghost of Nyack. The Ghost of Nyack is a very fascinating case because somebody bought a house, wasn't disclosed that it was supposed to be the most haunted house in America, and in turn, they took it to court, and the court kicked it back. And the people weren't satisfied, took it to the Supreme Court of the state of New York. The Supreme Court of the state of New York basically said, haunted houses are real, because if people believe it to be real, it's real. So therefore, that leads us to where real estate stigma is all about. Bill Mundy, who's a well-known professor in Washington State, once said, real estate stigma does not have to be real to be realized. And that is what it's all about. It's about perception. We have Ralph Nader, came out years back when I was a kid and wrote a book called Unsafe at Any Speed. He went and said the Corvair is the most dangerous car in North America. And it took years of investigation. And when it was over, it was no safer, no less safe than any other car. And when that came out, it was somewhere between the obituaries and the comics and the newspapers because it wasn't sensational. And I can go into all kinds of stuff. In Toronto, where I live, my town, Toronto, I just have to mention certain intersections and people know it for notorious crime. but I know it as neighborhoods where people raise their families and in peace. So people have perceptions. So basically what happens is when I look at the three decades I've been studying this, there are perceptions out there. There is a class distinction. The lower the economic class of a neighborhood, the greater the impact of word of mouth. They perceive it, they believe it. And basically, I look at that you're going to have a problem with safe injection sites. And the problem is, where are you going to put them? The problem's going to be people are going to perceive problems. What the public, the reality and the public's perception are two different things. The public will believe it. Word of mouth will be there. I look at stigma, and basically people are afraid because real estate values across this land are large. They're the highest they've ever been in history. People don't want anything to negatively impact their value. And that includes the retailers that have stores along a commercial strip or whatever. People are going to say, not in my backyard. So last thing I wanted to say is in Ontario, we have under Rule 21 of the Real Estate and Business Brokers Act 2002 about disclosure. It's called the material fact. Anything a real estate agent knows about a property, and that includes proximity, the real estate agent has to disclose. We have a problem with that bill. It is not defined. The regulation is not defined. But the worst problem in Ontario is there is no statute of limitations. It has to be disclosed forever. So with that said, I just want to reiterate one more thing. Like I said, real estate perception of depreciation or stigma doesn't have to be real to be realized. And with that, I'll wait for your questions. Thank you.
Fine. Thank you very much, Mr. LeBeau. And now we will go to Mr. McPherson, please.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes. Loud and clear, sir. You're on.
Okay, great. Thank you for inviting me to speak to this committee today on such an important issue for Canadians, especially those experiencing severe addiction and mental health issues. In our brief, which is a collaboration with the Canadian HIV/AIDS Legal Network, we have outlined many of the benefits of supervised consumption services around the world and our concerns with Bill C-2 as it is currently drafted. We, along with others appearing before you, have made the point that the services that Bill C-2 is focused on are evidence-based, have been around for close to 30 years in various jurisdictions, and are a part of a comprehensive approach to developing systems of care for people with severe addictions at the margins of society. I've worked for many years in the field of drug policy and have been a participant in the broad public discussion that has been taking place in Vancouver, BC, Canada, over the past 20 years, focused on building a more effective response to drug problems in our country. As a staff person with the City of Vancouver for 22 years, 10 of those working as the city's drug policy coordinator, I know only too well the challenges for municipalities and local health authorities attempting to do the right thing. That is to put in place a comprehensive system of care for people with drug problems in the community, and this includes drug treatment facilities, detox units, scaling up methadone programs, supportive housing projects for people with addictions and mental health issues, needle exchange projects, other types of social development programs, and yes, supervised consumption services. Because of the stigma of illegal drug use, each one of these services is a challenge for municipalities and health authorities to implement at the local level, and require a great deal of time, energy, commitment, and resources to actually get these services up and running and providing much needed help to people. Believe me, there is a great deal of public process at the local municipal level to actually situate any of the services that I have mentioned. Bill C-2 will add an extremely onerous extra layer of work for those at the local level that will most certainly have the effect of preventing the scaling up of supervised consumption services across the country where they may be needed. The 26 different pieces of information required before an application can even be considered would not be required of any other type of health service. At the very least, Bill C-2 will cause a significant delay for localities to implement a timely response to what are often the urgent realities realities of the unregulated illegal drug scene. An example of this urgency is the recent spate mentioned by my colleague of overdoses due to fentanyl in Vancouver, where the Vancouver police, to their credit, urged people to use Insight in an effort to prevent overdose deaths. 31 overdoses took place at Insight over Thanksgiving weekend, none of them fatal. This is a tool that other localities do not have access to at this time. We are very sorry that this legislation is not coming before the Standing Committee of Health on Health. After all, the primary purpose of supervised consumption services is to intervene in urgent public health contexts where vulnerable citizens are at high risk of serious and sometimes deadly consequences of injection drug use. Consumption services can mitigate these risks, including improving the health and safety of the communities where they might appropriately be located. A hearing only before the Public Safety and National Security Committee does not seem an adequate venue to consider the complexity of the health and social issues engaged by these kinds of services. Indeed, supervised consumption services are themselves a balanced approach in that they address both public health and public order issues in communities. Another contextual comment I wish to note is the great divide between the testimony from our health and enforcement colleagues. The divide between the leadership of these two fields of work in our communities is of concern to us and seems to be vast, with virtually all of the expert advice from professional health associations, including the Canadian Medical Association, the Canadian Nurses in AIDS Care, Vancouver Coastal Health, and the Toronto Public Health Department, finding Bill C-2 significantly problematic on a number of grounds. On the enforcement side of things, for the most part, in spite of all the evidence from existing supervised consumption services projects, it seems that there is not even a willingness to consider a trial or pilot project to see what the experience of different models in different localities might be. In the face of all of the evidence of 30 years of positive experience of integrated consumption services into the systems of care in Europe, Vancouver, and Sydney, Australia, there seems to be a firm position against any such trials on behalf of our police leadership. We think that this divide between these two critical fields of public service is unfortunate, as we are certain both health and enforcement institutions in this country share the goals of healthy, safe communities for all Canadian citizens, including those who use drugs. As we have written in our brief, by advocating a focus on public safety at the expense of public health, the context of these hearings being a prime example, the bill runs counter to the court's emphasis on striking a balance between public safety and public health. By making it even more difficult to implement supervised consumption services, Bill C-2 ignores the Supreme Court of Canada's assertion that these services are vital for the most vulnerable groups of people who use drugs, and that preventing access to these services violates human rights. In the words of the Chief Medical Health Officer of Vancouver Coastal Health, Bill C-2 is currently configured, will, quote, effectively act to block exemptions and the provision of life-saving medical services to some of our most marginalized citizens and result in deaths and serious illnesses that are entirely preventable, end of quote. If this is the case, it is our judgment that this clearly contradicts the spirit of the Supreme Court decision on Insight. Making it more difficult to open consumption services in Canada is clearly out of step with the commitment that this government has expressed to address Canada's serious mental health situation as well. Consumption services aim to engage marginalized people who use drugs. In Canada, the percentage of homeless people who had either a mental illness or a substance abuse diagnosis is 86%. And the percentage of homeless people with a mental illness who also have a substance abuse problem is 75%. Many of those who inject drugs would benefit greatly from the engagement with health, social workers, and drug treatment professionals through their participation in a comprehensive supervised consumption service program. At Vancouver's Insight, 65% of participants have had previous diagnosis of mental illness. Given these numbers, putting barriers in the way of implementing supervised consumption services seems at odds with this government's stated commitment towards the mentally ill in Canada. One would like to think that the government would want to facilitate the development of one more evidence-based tool in the toolbox to help address mental health and addictions in this country. A recent systematic review of injection sites released last week, conducted by 4 researchers from France and 1 from Switzerland, reviewed 75 relevant articles. The findings of the systematic review were all studies converged to find that supervised injection services were efficacious in attracting the most marginalized people who inject drugs, promoting safer injection conditions, enhancing access to primary health care, and reducing the overdose frequency. Supervised injection services were not found to increase drug injecting, drug trafficking, or crime in the surrounding environments, and supervised injection services were found to be associated with reduced levels of public drug injections and dropped syringes. I will close by reminding the committee that the issue of supervised consumption services came to the fore after a decade-long public health and public safety disaster in Vancouver and indeed British Columbia during the 1990s. Thousands of people died and many more became ill during this period. The epidemics of overdose, HIV, hepatitis C, and injection drug use overwhelmed Vancouver's inner city. At the time, Michael O'Shaughnessy, the director of the Center for Excellence in HIV/AIDS Research, coined the phrase deadly public policy to refer to the mix of municipal, provincial, and federal policies in the areas of social assistance, housing, mental health and addictions, lack of funding for health and social programs, and enforcement practices, etc., that contributed to inadvertently creating the conditions for an HIV epidemic among injection drug users to flourish in Vancouver. In British Columbia, much time has been spent trying to undo those deadly public policies with some good successes. If Bill C-2 is implemented in its current form, our organizations would certainly consider it to be a step backwards, creating yet another deadly public policy, as it clearly will have the impact of denying marginalized and often seriously ill Canadian citizens and their communities access to proven life-saving health services. I thank you very much.
Fine. Thank you, Mr. McPherson. And now let me correct my introduction. From the Canadian Police Association, the President, Tom Stamatakis.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and members of the committee, and thank you all for the invitation to address you this afternoon as part of your continued study of Bill C-2. As you mentioned, and as most of you know from my previous appearances before this committee, I have the privilege of currently serving as the president of the Canadian Police Association, an organization that represents over 54,000 frontline police personnel, both civilian and sworn officers across Canada. My opening remarks today will be brief. However, I've been closely following the testimony given by other witnesses before this committee, and the term evidence-based seems to be used quite often. So I'd like to offer you the following today, which should give you an idea of my experience in the area and why I particularly appreciate having the opportunity to present to you today. I've served for 25 years as a constable with the Vancouver Police Department, and currently, along with my duties at the CPA, the president of the Vancouver Police Union, where Canada's only supervised drug consumption site operates. I believe I can provide you today with an important and first-hand view around why public safety should be an important consideration when discussing supervised consumption sites. From a frontline policing perspective, Bill C-2 is an important piece of legislation that our association wholeheartedly supports, as we believe it strikes an appropriate balance between the needs of protecting community health while taking into account the very real concerns that have been raised by all levels of law enforcement and members of the community regarding supervised drug consumption sites. I know that your committee has heard concerns raised by opponents of this legislation that the conditions imposed by the bill are onerous and will be difficult for organizations seeking to open new sites to meet. As a police officer, I'm somewhat sympathetic to concerns that paperwork and regulatory frameworks can be difficult and at times even next to impossible to work within. However, I can say this is the environment that law enforcement professionals work within every day, and we don't have the option to cut corners or take the easy way out. Our efforts must be meticulous to pass muster by judges, Crown and defense attorneys, community stakeholders, as well as the myriad of oversight bodies that constantly police the police, and I don't think it's asking too much of those that wish to work with illicit and dangerous drugs to meet that same standard. I don't particularly want to use my appearance here today as a platform to relitigate the merits or drawbacks of supervised consumption sites, but while I will certainly concede that proponents of these sites are passionate advocates who are sincere in their beliefs, I can say that as a police officer who has patrolled and worked in the downtown east side, there is a significant public safety cost that absolutely must be considered when thoughts are given to opening new sites. The simple fact is the drugs that are consumed at these sites are illegal substances. An individual doesn't walk to their local pharmacist to obtain their drug of choice. There is a criminal act that takes place with the procurement of their drugs. With the gray area that has been created around InSite in the downtown east side, our officers are asked to exercise an incredible discretion in their policing efforts. But the drug dealers are ready and particularly eager to exploit this discretion to the fullest extent possible. Another unfortunate truth is that those who are using these drugs are not cashing in their RSPs, selling their stock options, or using their discretionary income to buy their illicit drugs. They're resorting to often desperate and most often criminal behavior in order to obtain the resources necessary to purchase the drugs. This leads to an increase in theft, assault, prostitution in the immediate area around the site, while they're sometimes attend to inject drugs. All of this comes at a cost. There are very few unbiased observers who would walk the downtown east side of Vancouver and claim, using only the eye test, that InSite is an overwhelming success. I certainly wouldn't claim that everything in the neighborhood would be rainbows and unicorns without the presence of InSite. It is an unfortunate and unavoidable byproduct of its continued operation. This isn't to suggest that we should turn our backs on those who have fallen victim to addiction. It would be impossible for me to list all of the initiatives taken by police services and other agencies across this country to deal with drug consumption. I firmly believe we can build on those programs that have been found to be successful. But while any drug initiatives vary widely in scope and in operation, the one constant is that public safety is never jeopardized and that the protection of our community's most vulnerable is always paramount. Unfortunately, the debate around InSite and any other proposed consumption sites has become extremely charged and in a number of cases very personal. I've witnessed and been targeted by those who don't appreciate my advocacy on behalf of my members in opposition to these sites, and while I do try to see the debate from their perspective, I hope today that they might try and see it from mine. I've walked the downtown east side, I've spoken regularly with police officers who are given the difficult and dangerous task of patrolling this area on a regular basis, and I can say without a doubt that while studies may trumpet the health benefits of supervised drug consumption, those same studies always underestimate the public safety cost that comes as a result. In our estimation, Bill C-2 is a reasonable response to the Supreme Court of Canada decision that allows InSite to continue operations. This proposed legislation doesn't close the door on new consumption sites, but it does set an appropriately high standard that needs to be met before these sites can open. It asks for input to be sought from a number of stakeholders, including law enforcement, and our association appreciates the steps taken by the government in this regard. I would like to conclude by offering one suggestion for amendment within the legislation. Section 56.3 specifies the consultation conditions that need to be met before the minister authorizes any new supervised drug consumption site. Subsection E says that a letter must be obtained from the head of the police force that is responsible for providing police services in the municipality in which the site seeks to operate. While this is a good first step, I believe that the legislation should go further. For instance, the Act itself should also specifically designate the president of the local police association, union, or staff relations representative as a key stakeholder in the process. While police executives must have a role in determining conditions for any drug site, the reality is that many executive positions within the police service are determined by a police board that can often be beholden to local politics, whatever they might be. In many jurisdictions across Canada, a police chief's employment is determined by the police board, which is dominated by provincial and municipal political appointments. The president of the local association, however, is elected solely by the frontline civilian and sworn members that make up the police service. And his views or her views would be shaped by those he or she represents and would be free to make those views known to the minister. Aside from that small change, the Canadian Police Association is happy to offer our support to Bill C-2, as we believe that public safety concerns do need to be put on par with community health concerns when it comes to supervised drug consumption sites. Once again, I thank you for the opportunity to appear today, as well as on behalf of my colleagues who were able to appear last week on this proposed legislation, and I look forward to any questions you might have. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much to all of our witnesses today. With the, of course, the impending bells, Mrs. Blonsky, you're up. You have about 5 or 6 minutes until bells.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone, for appearing. The committee has heard a great deal of testimony already, very strongly held views, some of them directly contradictory. So we have a little bit of sympathy for our minister who is seeking to sort out the merits of a particular proposal for a supervised injection site. On last week, we heard from the Ottawa Police Association and the Toronto Police Association. They testified that supervised injection sites perpetuate and encourage heavy, damaging drug use. They said that in creating injection sites, we create concentrated trafficking zones. Traffickers will carry only enough drugs to make small but frequent transactions, and if stopped by police, these traffickers will claim immunity, relying on the presumption of innocent possession with a known boundary around the supervised injection site. They say that supervised injection sites bring an increase in crime and list some of the crimes that they're concerned about, and that they contribute to social and economic deterioration and the further victimization where they are located. Now, I could go on, but I won't. But I'm just asking you, Mr. Stamatakis, whether these observations are in accordance with your own research and your own observations, or whether you would have something different to say.
Yeah, they're very much in accordance with my own observations and the experience of my members. I referred earlier to the incredible amount of discretion that police officers working in the downtown east side use every day when it comes to enforcement in the downtown east side, and it is very much related to enforcement related to how to deal with addicts, how to deal with traffickers who are preying upon the addicts, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think the underlying issue is that addiction does drive a lot of public safety challenges for any community for enforcement in a community. And I think, so I wouldn't attribute all of that necessarily to Insight and a safe consumption site, but what a place like Insight or a safe consumption site does is it does create an epicenter for that kind of activity and the challenges to occur. And I think if you look at the history of Vancouver, going back to 2003 when Insight was established, and you look at what the situation was today, versus what it was in 2003 versus what it is today, I'd be hard pressed to be able to describe to you what the clear benefits have been to having Insight operate in the downtown east side.
Mr. LeBeau, I take from your testimony that you feel that some of this characterization is simply stigmatizing such an area, and that there's more perception in the reality of danger. So I take it, sir, that you would not be adverse to a supervised injection site next door to where you and your family live.
Or where my store or office would be either.
Sorry?
Or where my store or office would be.
Right. Do you think that some of your neighbors or fellow business people where you have your business would feel differently about that?
No. The public perception, word of mouth, is too strong. All the
so
studies of stigma.
So you don't think that they would have a different opinion than you about this?
Not when it comes to their own value. No, not if they're owners of property.
So no one in your neighborhood would object to having a supervised injection site next door?
Oh, they would object, of course. Right. Sorry, misunderstood you.
So, you know, do you feel that their opinion should be taken into account or only yours?
No, their opinion very much so.
So the bill, of course, allows a minister to gather viewpoints and information from a wide variety of individuals and organizations that would be affected. Do you see a problem with this?
No, not at all.
So the process in the bill to try to gather opinion and information is something that the minister is seeking. Mr. McPherson, do you see a difficulty or objection to having input by groups and individuals and authorities that will have to deal with these sorts of sites?
Very briefly, Mr. McPherson, the bells are going. Quick response, if you would, sir. Please feel free to for a quick response.
But Bill C-2 doesn't realize there is a tremendous amount of consultation that goes on at the city level through development permit board hearings and notifications of residents for any new use, whether it be a detox center, an injection site, or a police department. The community is consulted on all these things, and that's a tremendous amount of work at the local level.
Fine. Thank you very much. Well, the committee will be abbreviated today due to obviously, the bell's going, and we certainly, on behalf of the entire committee, thank our witnesses for appearing here today. We thank you for your testimony, and please travel safely. Thank you again. Adjourned.